Up to this point, we have derived equations for inviscid, incompressible, and irrotational flow. And we came up with a continuity equation, which is del dot V equals zero. So that's the continuity equation. That's the conservation of mass. And then we've also used Newton's second law to look at conservation of momentum and come up with what are called the Euler equations, which is the partial of V with respect to T plus del 1/2 V squared plus P over rho plus GH, where the gravitational force is the only body force on the fluid, equals zero, and it's a conservative body force. So these are called the Euler equations. Now the Euler equations have three components because it's a vector, right? So and then the gradient of a scalar here. So these are actually three equations, and the continuity equation is a scalar equation, because a del dot V, although these are vectors themselves, once you do the dot product, that becomes a scalar. This is a scalar equation, and these are vector equations. So we have three equations from the Euler equations and one from the continuity equation. And so that gives us actually four equations, and we have four unknowns, which are the three components of velocity, our velocity vector, and our pressure throughout the fluid. So those are the four unknowns that we'd like to solve for throughout the fluid. And these give us the four equations that allow us to solve for those four unknowns. Now, because we are dealing with inviscid irrotational flow, we have an additional piece of information here that's going to turn out to be very important. So these were the equations that we had before we looked at potential flow, but from potential flow we've learned that the velocity vector, if I have to write this out here, potential flow, from potential flow we learned that the velocity vector can be expressed as the gradient of a scalar called the velocity potential. So if we now plug that into the continuity equation, we get del dot V can actually be written as del dot del phi. Or, in other words, you can also write this as del squared phi. Now, this is called Laplace's equation. And it is a very, very common differential equation that shows up in physics and has been studied by many researchers, not only in the field of fluid mechanics, but also other fields. So it's a very common equation that has been studied a lot, and there are a lot of solutions to this. And by the way, I need to say that this equals zero for the continuity equation. So in fact, let me just erase this right here. Really, we want a line all around this. So del squared phi equals zero is Laplace's equation. And there are a lot of solutions. So basically, what we need to find in order to solve Laplace's equation is we need to find a scalar field defined by phi. Now, because phi can be a function of x and y and z. So phi can change with x, y, and z. And if we take del squared of phi, that equals zero at every point in the flow. And if that's true, then we satisfy the continuity equation for this inviscid, incompressible, irrotational flow. So we can write out this equation in its components here. So it can also be written as the partial squared of phi with respect to x squared plus the partial squared of phi with respect to y squared plus the partial squared of phi with respect to z squared equals 0. Now, this is in Cartesian coordinates. You can write something similar in both cylindrical or spherical coordinates. But like I said, and I'll just write that here, this is in Cartesian coordinates. But like I said, there are many, many known solutions to this equation. And one nice benefit of this equation is that if you have two different solutions that both satisfy this equation, you can actually add the two solutions together, and the summation of those two solutions will still satisfy Laplace's equation. So that means that these are additive. We can add different components here. If we know some solutions that apply for certain situations or whatnot, we can add those together, and the summation of these will also satisfy Laplace's equation. Another nice thing about using Laplace's equation and looking at potential flow instead of our original set of equations that I drew up or wrote up here, the nice thing is that we actually just have to find one scalar quantity now. We have to find one scalar throughout the flow, and once we do that, we can actually back out what v is, because the velocity vector, all three components of velocity are defined by that scalar. It's just the gradient of that scalar. So once we've found the scalar value at every point in the flow, we have three components of velocity, and so we actually... when we come back up here to our set of equations, we know the three components of velocity. All we're missing is pressure. Pressure can be solved here using the Euler equations. And so instead of using all four of these equations, which both of these are differential equations up here that we talked about, instead of using all four of those simultaneously to solve for these four unknowns, the three components of velocity and the pressure, we instead can just solve for some phi, some scalar throughout the flow field. And once we know that, we take the gradient of that to get the velocity. And then our only unknown is pressure. We can come up here to the Euler equations and solve for the pressure. So that's one benefit of using potential flow or looking at this from a velocity potential perspective. So let's look at really quickly what the what boundary conditions on this velocity potential might look like. Now, these are actually going to be the boundary conditions for any simulation or analysis that we would do. But let's take an airfoil again and say that we have flow moving over that airfoil, and what we need to do is satisfy some boundary conditions along the surface here. So the surface boundary condition is defined by forcing the flow to be tangential to the surface, along the surface. And so the way that we write that is that our surface boundary condition is going to be that v, the velocity, dotted with the normal, if we've got a little normal here, at every point along the surface, has to be equal to zero. Well, because we know that v is related to the velocity potential, another way to write that is that the gradient of phi dot n equals zero. So that's our boundary condition at the surface. And then we're also going to have a what's called a far field boundary condition. And so our solutions, by the way, these boundary conditions give us constraints on our solutions here. And so our solutions have to satisfy that that the velocity dot n along the surface is equal to zero. And at the far field, that velocity, our velocity, has to be equal to some free stream velocity. You know, if we were to move far enough away from this airfoil, we'd get back to a point where the flow field was unaffected by the presence of that object. And that velocity vector would be our v infinity velocity vector. So in the far field, our velocity has to approach v infinity, or in terms of the velocity potential, del cross phi out at infinity must be equal to V infinity. So those are two very common boundary conditions that we're going to use in order to find solutions to this flow field that satisfy Laplace's equation and also satisfy these boundary conditions.